Within the wheelhouse of shonen manga, few reach the heights of Hiromu Arakawa's 2001 series Full Metal Alchemist. Part of me honestly hesitates to relegate it just being called a shonen, as I feel it carries this connotation that you shouldn't take it as seriously as something like Monster or something of the matter. But, I mean, it carries the tag anyway, so it's fair game, let's fucking go for it. Truth be told, I actually am really glad that it is relegated as a shonen, because Brotherhood is one of my favorite anime of all time, and without that, I wouldn't, legally speaking, be able to talk about it on this show, but fuck it, we got it. So, I'm Michael, and this is Building the Ark, where we try to build the best shonen known to man and piss in the face of God while we're at it. This is our third case, Fullmetal Alchemist Leora arc. Let's go. Fullmetal Alchemist was published in Square Enix's monthly shonen Gangan in 2001. Man, fuck that. It's fucking Fullmetal Alchemist. Literally everyone knows what the fuck this is, and I probably rewatched it like a bajillion times. It's the number one anime on MAL, for God's sakes. Do you know how hard it is to get weeps to agree on like anything? So, fuck history, let's just do the damn thing. I made a pretty ballsy ass claim in the last Building the Arc where I said that Leora is the best opening arc to a shonen ever. Well, you see, I still stand by that, this arc's killer. But see, I could just leave you on, this is the best opening arc to a shonen ever, or I could tell you why this arc makes me as excited as a West Virginian at a family reunion. And that's the name of the game, because we're on episode 3 of this shit, and you should already know this by now. Tortured simile behind us, let's talk about our piece of the ship for the day. And that is, your first arc should be the thesis statement to your entire series. I briefly mentioned this when speaking about Orangetown and how that functioned as a test to see if someone would actually like how One Piece is structured. That's pretty much just a structural thesis, while Leora functions more on a thematic level. Now for the 3 or 4 chocolate idol knuckle dragon bucket headed dim-witted square bowling balls of the human race out there who haven't actually finished Fullmetal Alchemist, I will refrain from spoilers. I will also try to remain civil because for some reason at the time of writing, FMA discourse is at an all-time high, and just cards on the table, I like Brotherhood the most. Whoa, no way, you like Brotherhood the most? Oh man, you should change your name from Bad Lad to Mad Lad. Yeah, I know, if my takes were soup, this would be gazpacho. But you see, unlike some people who really like Brotherhood, I understand the noble truth that all Fullmetal Alchemist is valid. Because everything in this series is fucking awesome. I don't know if I missed like an anniversary of one of the PS2 games or something, but like Fullmetal Alchemist has really been on the rise online, just people talking about it. I remember on Discord, my friend Foxcade told me, he said, "Hey Michael, here's this script for Fullmetal Alchemist I'm writing for my next big video. What do you think about it?" And I almost choked him through my phone. I know that's like impossible, but I really wanted to pull that. Because that fucking boomer just mind snatched me and I'm so mad. So now he does his 40 minute review of the entire series and I'm stuck here doing my 12 minute review of just sloppy seconds. Fan fucking tastic. Thanks a lot, you fuck. Okay, wait, where was I going with the— oh, yeah, that's it. So another reason I'm really avoiding spoilers in this video is I want to do my own review of the series and kind of give my personal history with it, because Fullmetal Alchemist is honestly just a really important anime to me and I really love talking about it. With that cleared up, I like the way that the first Fullmetal series does Leora just that little bit more, even if it isn't really conducive to where that series ends up going. The fact that Leora is Brotherhood's third episode is kind of redundant when you think about it, like, oh, here's how our universe works and how our powers work. And then Leora saunters in like the gifted middle child playing follow-up actor's three-year-old brother's rendition of Old MacDonald. Sure, it's better and more fleshed out, but when you start low and do the same thing again, people most likely won't tune in and God, I fucking hate you, Mason. What I'm getting at is, Brotherhood treats you like you're stupid and says, "Did you get all that? No. No, you didn't. No way did you get all that in one episode. Do it again." And what's more, that first episode fucking sucks. Like, when I watched it when I was like 14, I was like, "Dude, this is sick. Look at that bat. It looks just like him." But now I watch it, and again, it's redundant. I'm like, why is this here? Why do I need this? I don't need this. Take it back. It's like a bad joke. You'll hear it until you laugh or break your friend's windpipe, whatever comes first. It being the curtain jerker for the 2003 series really just ropes in an audience. The 2003 series is just a lot better at following the opening motions of the manga and just rings the audience for everything they're worth when it comes to those emotional moments. Too bad the rest of the series is fucking batshit crazy. Still recommend. Good show. Also, I rewatched this first two episodes a few days ago. My notes here say mention Lost in episode one. And I gotta say, that's actually a really nice touch that I don't remember in the manga. Actually, you know, give me like 2 seconds real quick. Yeah, no, I just double checked the manga. She's not in that scene. That scene's really short. So for her to just be there and be like, oh, you guys don't know who the Elrics are? One, that's like, oh, these guys are big deals, I guess. And then when you see what she does to Cornello at the end of the arc, you're like, wait a minute. That lady knows who Ed and Al are. That lady's fucking scary. And it just sows this like seed of just fear. It's like, shit. It's like your grandma just sewing your fucking pants back together after you rip them in church. It's like, thanks, Graham. Damn, this is tight. Now, walk back to the Purest Paradise. The manga also opens with this arc. But what it does best, and honestly, I haven't seen any series really do it since, is it gets all its shit in at page one. All the major themes that run throughout the lifeblood of the show are just laid bare on the first page and is mind-blowing upon a reread. For brevity's sake, we'll just list these and then I'll leave it at that. If you know when in the series they actually come back, then you do. If you don't, go watch the show. What am I, your mom? I'm not gonna tell you everything. Honestly, let's just take a moment just to admire the composition of this page. Just from the situation itself, to Ed's inability to accept that he's failed, to a big bold text that says, a painless lesson is meaningless. One who does not sacrifice anything cannot achieve anything. These three pieces put together form the entire thematic thesis of the series. The rest of this arc, thematically speaking, is redundant just because the audience received all necessary info on page one. That last one is actually really interesting to focus on because worded slightly differently, you get humankind cannot gain anything without first giving something in return. To obtain, something of equal value must be lost. For the more perceptive members of my audience, or people who've actually like watched this shit, you'll know that that's just alchemy's first law of equivalent exchange. Which brings me to a good point, alchemy. Alchemy is one of the best power structures in shonen history. But the thing is, you don't really think of it as a power structure now, do you? Now, okay, that's me projecting right there because I didn't really think of it as a power structure because I didn't really think Fullmetal Alchemist was a shonen for a long time. So let's take this moment for a little exercise. Let's look at Yu Yu Hakusho. With spirit slash demon slash sacred energy, you hear people say all the time, holy fuck man, Toguro's super fucking strong, look at his energy. Or, dude, Sensui's crazy. He was way stronger than Toguro.
You fool! I have 70 alternative accounts!
And then it's like, dude, Yomi though. Yomi's the shit. You don't have that in Fullmetal Alchemist. Like, the closest you get in Fullmetal Alchemist is just people going, man, that Elric boy, he's sure dang good at alchemy, isn't he? The only person you really get that sense of like, holy shit, look how strong they are, is Father. And that's not really told to you. You just see that because of how hard they get their shit pushed in. Alchemy is one of the like tightest power structures in shonen, up there with Nen and kicking your opponent in the thigh a la Gintama. What makes alchemy such an interesting structure is it clearly has more uses than just combat. As much as I really hate to drag the comparison up, it reminds me of magic from, please don't shoot me, Fairy Tail. Put the pitchforks down, let me explain. In Fairy Tail, they make it clear that magic is pretty mundane and almost anyone can do it. They just have uses for it for daily activities. There are just some people who are really good at fighting with it. Alchemy is basically just magic but good. As in, while magic is just flimsy and boils down to a numbers game, alchemy is a hard-line science, meant to be researched and examined. Alchemy is tight and structured and has almost no holes. Sure, there's a few holes, but plot holes are for fucking nerds! So let's get back to Lior. On a narrative level, Lior is the epitome of great things come in small packages. The physical equivalent of that is my Uncle Terry. For being two chapters, the audience really gets a lot to latch onto, especially in the character of Rose. This I really just gotta give to the 2003 adaptation, where it actually shows the failure of resurrecting her boyfriend. Something that the manga and Brotherhood just kinda shuffle under the rug. That extra layer of tragedy, and seeing Rose's reaction to it, and her being saved by Al, that really adds to where she goes in that series. And if you kinda just like Frankenstein that together where she goes in the other series, That's fucking cool as hell. Why didn't they keep that? I love that. Not to take away from Arakawa's original vision, but the fact that the audience cares so much about this character who's relevant for a collective 5 seconds, that's fucking crazy. Her crisis of faith is one entire character arc set up in 2 chapters and in 2 episodes in the anime, and her development happens off screen. So when she comes back later in any series, it feels like her arc is fully complete because every baseline was hit in her first introduction. Now, talking about characters, you can't overlook the Elrics, except Ed, yuck yuck. No, honestly, I love the Elrics. They are some of the best shonen pro tags in the game. They're just so likable, and the audience just has this great connection. They're just funny, interesting, and honestly relatable. The fact that their goal isn't something like become king of whatever, or be the best like no one ever was. Their goal is simply to atone for past mistakes any way they can, and to just try and live that normal life they always wanted. That's a pretty unique goal, as one would think there's not much to it, but atonement is really one of the hardest things to attain ever. I just adore the way these two personalities bounce off each other, and just off to other characters, because Ed and Al have this anchor to them. And all great fictional characters have a character anchor. Something that no matter what they do, you can always trace back to this core aspect of their person. A good example of this is Homer Simpson, stick with me here. Now, no matter how dumb you think Homer is or how wacky he's being, you can always trace back the fact that he loves his family more than anything. Now, I mean, after season 9, you can't, and you know what? I'm just gonna link the Real Jim's channel and Zombie Simpson's essay in the description. Let's just get back on topic. Ed and Al are grounded, sensible characters, so anything they do has a clear motive and deliberation behind it. Nothing seems random or out of character. There's nothing that Ed and Al care about more than each other. That orbit point for their character makes everything they do sympathetic, logical, and most of all, likable. If the Elrics become unlikable, then the audience probably wouldn't be as keen to follow them. Now, do you need a likable pro tag for your narrative to work? No, not all the time. A good example would be Holden Caulfield, who's just kind of a sad sack edgelord, but you can grasp where he's coming from. It's that character anchor I was talking about. The Elrics have the advantage of being both understandable, fleshed out characters, and just being a few likable chaps. Now, by all means, I wouldn't say Ed is likable right out the gate, mostly because of that scene. You know the one I'm talking about. The Bible, read in a condescending voice by a 14-year-old atheist. I feel like this scene has a weird aura surrounding it. It's just one of those things that you're either like 10 and love and go, heh, another fucking zealot pwned. Or you say, oh god, how cringy, this series is completely ruined, and you just have an aneurysm. Or you could be a brain lord and say, well, that's just kind of edgy and a weird delivery, but the idea of the scene is what matters. And that idea is that aforementioned crisis of blind faith. Both Ed and Rose believe their own creed without much question. Back on page 1, Ed questions how could this have failed when he followed it exactly. That's straight blind faith there. And that's one of the more admirable traits of this series. Arakawa does a really good job of not saying what side she thinks is air quote right. To a brainlet, they would say, oh, it's clear she's biased against blank. The difference between science and religion is really blurred in Fullmetal Alchemist's world. The idea that Cornelio's miracles are acts of science without law does actually classify them as miracles, but there's just a logical explanation as to why they're happening. Speaking of Cornelio, he's an oft-remembered antagonist that, if I'm being honest, is just okay. Functionally, he's the sacrificial lamb of the series to show how dangerous our main antagonist can be, and sow this fear into the audience for the Elric's safety, just like I was talking about, you split your pants in church, goddamn grandma! That leads me rather nicely into the homunculi. The homunculi are some of Shonen's greatest villain groups, not because they're a solid unit that fully cooperates, quite the opposite actually. The fact that they all think differently than each other and have distinctive personalities that tend to clash make them far more interesting than if they were just united under whatever father believed. Some are, but then you have an outlier like Greed who ends up being most people's favorite character. But for now, we're stuck with Lust and Gluttony, and they're okay. I really do like Lust, but Gluttony is... He's the Nami rule. He had to be my least favorite because he just doesn't do nothing for me. Like, his power is cool, but he just lacks a personality other than being dumb. But I just... it's so weird because he's just this kind of whatever character, but all the other homunculi are fucking sweet. Shout out to Sloth, by the way. He is like my spirit animal, and just doing this recording right now is just
a pain.
I've said quite a lot about things like theme and characters, but if I'm you, I'm thinking one thing. And then me being me would respond in kind with, but beyond that, let's take a quick look back at that piece I threw up at the beginning. Your first arc should be your thesis statement to your entire series. Now, anyone who passed high school English should be able to tell that a thesis statement should be brief but hits hard. That is exactly what FMA does here. In two chapters, Arakawa walks in, steals your boyfriend, makes him do that funny dance he used to do for you, but now he's dressed like Ed. What I'm saying is, isolated, Lior is a wonderful story about clashing ideals of science and religion, and where we as people draw that line. But within the greater context of the rest of FMA, Lior is a stepping stone into one of the greatest manga and anime series of all time. Like all good stepping stones, you can look back at the end of the line and see where it all began, and reminisce on how good those times were. All the reasons listed above is why I say Lior is the best opening arc to a shonen to date. Fight me if you will, but I'm just gonna block you. Expect me to revisit this arc one day in the future, will you? Fuck! On episode 3, I already limited myself by just saying, hey, here's the best opening arc, fucking take it. Now, we're not quite out of the woods of talking about opening arcs in shonens just yet, because we have to make one more stop to the death pits. And within those grimy, dirty, moldy, clean up your shit, Tommy, those death pits, we will have our first Building the Arc verses between Yu Yu Hakusho's Spirit Detective Saga and Bleach's Substitute Shinigami Saga to see which is truly the better opening arc of the two. I'll see you all next time. I've been Michael. This is Building the Arc. What the? Get the fuck out of my house!
Undertale.